Welcome everyone to our research and collection seminar series. This is our third talk in the seminar series and our second talk, which has a Channel Islands focus in preparation for our upcoming exhibition. And so it is my pleasure to introduce our speaker today. Our speaker is Dr. Torben Rick. Dr. Rick is curator and research scientist in the Department of Anthropology at the Natural Museum of Natural History of the Smithsonian Institution. Dr. Rick served as chair of the department from 2014 to 2018 and is also an affiliated researcher at the Max Planck Institute for the Science of Human History and adjunct faculty member at George Washington University and the University of Maryland. Dr. Rick, University of Oregon, as well as his math science and his bachelor's at UC Santa Barbara, just up the road from us. Dr. Rick has a very prolific publishing career with over 200 publications, mostly focused on coastal and island adaptations, historical ecology, marine ecology, archaeology. Some of this we'll hear about today, and he has a particular focus on the Channel Islands, which we're very excited about. And he's had many archaeological expeditions over the years, especially to the Channel Islands. He's also been a curator or co-curator on a number of different expeditions, specifically evolving around the Anthropocene or related to ocean and marine science. So with that, I am excited to welcome Dr. Rick.
Well, thank you for that introduction. Thank you so much for having me, and greetings from the Washington, D.C. suburbs. I really hope all of you are doing well in the greater Los Angeles area during this crazy time that we're living in. Today, what I hope to do is transport us all out to the California Channel Islands and offer an escape from the present and give us an exciting look at the amazing archaeological record that sits just offshore of the California coast. Ultimately, what I hope to do is demonstrate how archaeology, or the study of the human past, can help us understand present-day biodiversity and play an important role in the management of California island ecosystems into the future. Long-term perspectives that span centuries to millennia, like those of archaeology, have a great deal to tell us about past environmental and anthropogenic change, and they provide perspective on the biodiversity crisis, climate change, and scores of other issues that characterize the Anthropocene or age of humans that we are now living in. So one of the things that always amazes me about the Channel Islands is that you can be in Los Angeles or Ventura or Santa Barbara or somewhere else, one of the cities in California, and within just a short boat ride, you can be transported out to a world that is totally different, totally relaxing, totally free from the mainland development, and gives you a feeling of kind of what California really used to be like. You can go from that setting of LA there on the top down to a view from the Torrey Pines on Santa Rosa Island in the bottom. What I want to do today is kind of highlight just some of how special the Channel Islands are from an archaeological record. And I have two main goals. The first part of this talk is going to focus a lot on Channel Island archaeology. And I want to put that in global context. So I'm going to take you to a couple other islands and coastlines around the world to start for the first 5 minutes or so. And then we're going to dive right into the archaeology of the Channel Islands. And my point in doing this is really to try to show you guys just how important the record of the California island archaeology is on a global stage. And then what I want to do is demonstrate how this archaeological record is helping us look at Channel Island ecosystems and biodiversity of the present more broadly. So in a sense, our work can provide a roadmap to understand how we got to the present and can help provide some perspective on where we want to go in the future. And before I go further, I also want to mention that what I plan today is rather than a deep dive research talk, what I'm planning to do is give you more of a highlight reel. So sort of highlights of what we've done, the projects I've been involved in, and what that tells us about the Native American occupation of the Channel Islands for 10,000 years. And then a similar thing with some of the biodiversity work that we're doing. And a lot of this, I'll just say, is backed up by really in-depth research. And if anybody has specific questions about that, we can deal with that at the end. All right, so let's start. We're gonna start outside of California and take a really quick, like, 5-minute walk through coastal archaeology around the world. And I guess 25 years ago or so, when I was still an undergraduate and first getting interested in archaeology, the seacoast and coastlines had sort of a problem in archaeological thought. Most archaeologists saw them as sort of cultural backwoods. They weren't as important as terrestrial areas. You know, they were occupied maybe, you know, sometime after about 5,000 years ago. And really, it wasn't until people had exhausted and used up all the great terrestrial areas. And sure, people were doing seafaring and all those things, but really those came about quite late in the human story. And what started happening about 3 decades ago is that just got totally turned on its head. And over the last couple decades, and certainly within the last 10 years, we've seen just an incredible amount of research show us just how important the seacoast was in the human past, and just how important the occupation of various island groups was, and how the antiquity or the deep time span in which people occupied islands extends really, really far back on the order of tens of thousands of years or more. And so one of the sites or one of the areas that has really proven important for turning that idea that coastlines weren't important on its head comes from South Africa, where a couple of cave sites, Blombos Cave being one, map on the bottom of the map there, and another one next to it, a Pinnacle Point, show us marine food use by modern humans going back 150 or 165,000 years. And this coincides with the timing, roughly with the timing of anatomically modern humans. So there were people harvesting littoral resources, shellfish, scavenging marine birds and other things very early on in South Africa. This is a look from Chris Henschelwood's work at Blombos Cave in South Africa. And I can't emphasize enough how important this work was in transforming our thinking about the role of the sea and ultimately what it did for our research in California. This is our look at some of the artifacts obtained from there, really, really important shell beads, scrapers, neat bifacial technologies, that these particular ones here date to about 70,000 years ago. There's some simpler technologies and blade technologies that go back beyond 100,000 years ago. Other sites that have come out, even just recently, this one was reported back in March, just before the lockdown, a new finding of coastal resource used by Neanderthals in Portugal at a series of caves here showing marine food use back to 86 to 100,000 years old by another member of our own genus Homo. And so these sites just give you a quick example of what are quickly emerging as numerous sites around the world that show us the value of coastal resources for the human story. And the question then becomes, well, what about islands? You know, islands are a little trickier, especially offshore islands and islands like Hawaii, where you've got to travel hundreds or more miles to reach them, require sophisticated boats and other things. And we've seen paralleling that use of coastal resources, paralleling that early use of those littoral foods is pushing back the chronology of the colonization of various islands. And I just want to highlight a couple of those that'll lead us right into the story of the California Channel Islands. I put this quote up here because it sort of typifies where we've come from. And about 1995 was when I was a second year undergrad, just getting into archaeology. And Pat Kirch, a pretty famous Polynesian archaeologist, really argued and pretty clearly that for a long time, people had thought that islands, and particularly Polynesia, were just on the route to nowhere. You know, this is one of the last places on Earth to discover. They're just a footnote in the grand chapters of world archaeology. And what Pat went on to show is they're nothing short of a miraculous story. They're not a footnote. These really represent some of the most amazing parts of our story. And since that paper he wrote in 1995, we've seen all sorts of interesting island colonizations. One of the earliest, of course, is going into Australia. So out of greater Southeast Asia, and a series of island hopping events that happened greater than 50 into 15,000 years ago. One of the ones I think is really keen and really interesting because it has some technologies that look similar to things we see on the Channel Islands, comes from Jeremali Cave on Timor. And this is an island group where we have now human occupation very deep offshore 42,000 years ago. And then these fishhooks here date to about 10 to to 13,000 years old as well. And then, you know, the story just goes on when we go to other island groups. So the Mediterranean has a late Pleistocene into the Holocene colonization. And you can mirror some of the movements of domesticates around Southwest Asia and into Europe that also trend out to Cyprus and other islands back 10,000 or more years ago. And you see the same thing when you come to the Caribbean, which is occupation of islands there pushed back over 7,000 years. And then the story, of course, of Micronesia, Melanesia, Polynesia is all very distinct and diverse. And Hawaii, New Zealand, some of those places were colonized much later, really within the last 1,000 years or so. But still, they represent really interesting transitions as we've seen the sort of use of marine foods, the development of sophisticated maritime seafaring technologies, all taking a very important role in our understanding of broader human life ways. And Madagascar sort of represents, I think, the new frontier in that realm, and that Madagascar, there's a huge debate right now about whether or not it was colonized over 12,000 years ago or as recent as 1,000 years ago. And of course, given all the endemic primates and other organisms out there, it's really interesting to get a handle on when people first got out there and might have started manipulating and altering some of those landscapes. So what does this have to do with the California Channel Islands, and why, you know, what about the islands? How do they fit into this broader story? For a long time, you know, the Channel Islands fell in that category of us thinking that they were occupied relatively recently too. As recently as like the late 1980s, there were a couple archaeologists saying, you know, these islands probably weren't really occupied very much till after 5,000 years ago, after the Middle Holocene. And it took research on the mainland coast to show, no, there were sites 8,000 to 9,000 years ago on the coast. And then some research actually at Daisy Cave, a pretty famous site first excavated by Charles Roser of the LA County Museum and collections you guys still have in your holdings. Revisiting those materials by the University of Oregon, where I went to grad school, showed that no, there were actually people out there 12,000 years ago. And since that work at Daisy Cave, the things have just kind of blown open, and we've seen a really long colonization history there. And that colonization story is just one part of it, because the archaeological record of the Channel Islands is really second to none. The lack of development we see out there, the real lack of burrowing animals, gives us incredible preservation that goes from what we think is initial colonization sometime around 13,000 years ago, that goes all the way up till the last of the island Chumash were removed to mainland missions in the early 1820s. And then at that time, after that time, you start seeing Chinese sites with black abalone camps. You get into interesting ranching period occupations, and the kind of human story continues into the present day era of conservation and management. So what I want to do is walk us through this occupational history, the Native American occupation of the Channel Islands, through a lens of work that I've been involved in and led or been a collaborator on over the last 20 years or so. I'll give this away that, one, I said it's kind of like a highlight reel, so a sort of broad brush rather than a deep dive into a specific topic. And also, I'm going to admit from the get-go that I am totally biased to the Northern Channel Islands. So I'm going to be talking a lot about the Northern Channel Islands and not too much about the Southern Islands. There's a lot of things that parallel what's going on in the Southern Islands, and there's a spectacular record there too. And if there are any specific questions into the Southern Islands, I'm happy to talk about those later. But most of my research is focused up north in San Miguel, Santa Rosa, Santa Cruz, and Anacapa Island. Of course, the Channel Islands, the Northern and Southern Channel Islands, are the ancestral land of the Chumash and the Gaborilino Tongva, both of whom are very active in island collections and island archaeology today. I work very closely with the Chumash, particularly members of the San Ynez Band coastal groups. And I put this old school diorama in here, which I believe is from a picture so old I can hardly remember. I believe it's from the Santa Barbara Museum of Natural History, just to give us a reminder of how special the island Chumash were. You know, when Europeans came in and first contacted the Chumash and then started describing and writing down aspects of Chumash life ways in the 18th century and early 19th century, they recorded what we would later realize are some of the most densely populated and socio-politically sophisticated hunter-gatherers anywhere on Earth. They had no real system of agriculture like you see in the Southwest with maize cultivation, mostly getting a lot of their food resources from marine foods, collecting acorns, geophytes out on the Channel Islands, a diverse suite of terrestrial mammals and birds as well. But mostly from wild foods. Now, that doesn't mean that they were not in tune with their environment. They were, and the Chumash had a wide variety of landscape management practices, some of which we're just starting to get a better handle on our understanding of which, and I'll go into some of those a little bit briefly at the end of the talk. And of course, the Chumash were, you know, had little gardens of tobacco and things of that nature as well. All right, so just to kind of lay the groundwork as we get ready to walk through these different examples of Channel Island archaeology and kind of a focus on sites and the things we've learned from those archaeological sites, most of the work we've done has been collaborative. So I was a grad student up at the University of Oregon, and from a very early on had it instilled in me that archaeology, like most science, was a team sport. And so, you know, our projects involved everyone from undergraduate students, occasionally high schoolers, to graduate students, to faculty members. And we're also very interdisciplinary. So we rely on that whole suite of techniques for dealing with the past, everything from radiocarbon dating to stable isotope analysis of shells for climate change research, to stable isotope analysis of fishes, foxes, you name it, to understand diet and ecology through time. So we really pride ourselves on not only being big interdisciplinary teams within archaeological science itself, but we collaborate a lot with researchers in the biological sciences, the geological sciences, and elsewhere too. I often like to think that in the case of the Channel Islands work, we can be a nexus that can help bridge some of the geological work, some of the biological work, and try to kind of bring that all together, centered around human life ways and human cultural practices. So what I'm going to walk you through now is based on, I don't say lightly, it's work at over 100 sites now with our broader team that involves a suite of collaborators from San Diego State University to the University of Oregon and elsewhere. All right, so let's start. We're going to start back in time, and I'll talk just briefly about a couple of the sites we've excavated that are some of the oldest sites on the Channel Islands, and ultimately how that feeds into one of the most important questions, which is that origins of the peopling in the Americas when people first got there. And this is a topic I'm sure many of you are familiar with, because Amy Gusick has been a real leader in work on understanding maritime migrations and some of the earliest Channel Islanders. And she's doing something that I think is crucial that we've been remiss in for a long time, which is exploring the underwater archaeological frontier. So that picture on the left there shows kind of our look at two migration routes, the purple one being a coastal migration, the orange one being a terrestrial migration through what we call the ice-free corridor. There are a few topics that elicit more anger and hostility and passion than the peopling of the Americas. And I tend to lean towards seeing a coastal route as a much more viable route for the earliest one. And certainly the work on the Channel Islands has helped blow that open. But it's very challenging. We have older sites in the interior than we do on the coast. We have older sites in South America than we do up in North America, all of which make it a really fluid and kind of difficult area to pin down. But as you'll see in a second, the Channel Islands have certainly some of the oldest definitively coastal sites and definitively maritime sites, meaning we know just by their distance from the mainland that people had to use watercraft to get to them. So one of our most famous sites, this is not work that I did, but I would be really remiss if I didn't mention his work at the Arlington Springs site, first discovered by Phil Orr of the Santa Barbara Museum of Natural History in 1959, and then revisited in the mid to late 90s by John Johnson, and they're still kind of working up reconstruction of that. But there were a couple of human bones from a single individual's two femurs and a patella, I believe. They ended up dating to around 13,000 calibrated calendar years. You can see the red arrow pointing to the stratigraphy in which it was pulled from in this deep canyon cut at Arlington Canyon. And that's our baseline. The Arlington Springs site is really important in that it tells us there were people on the Channel Islands by 13,000 years ago, but there's no artifacts with those human remains. There's no real signs of what that person was doing at the site. I think pretty soon we're going to get some isotope data and other things from the human remains themselves. But until that point, it's sort of a postcard that says, hey, we were here, but it left a lot of questions about what people's lifeways were like at this time. About 10 years ago, John Erlinson and I were wandering around near the Arlington area and looking at some other sites that Phil Orr had found, one of which was SRI 26 that Phil Orr thought might be, you know, dated the early Holocene or maybe even earlier. And then we ended up stumbling across some of these artifacts that you see on the right-hand side there, those beautiful, what we call CIBs or Channel Island barb points on the left. The middle ones are lunates or crescents, chipstone crescents. And then we've got a couple other point types on the right there, and then some red ochre down in the bottom middle of that. So we started finding some of these objects eroding out of this sort of Badlands Arroyo cut that you can see on the left there with Erlinson sort of perched in the middle of it. And we ended up finding a site was called SRI 512. And that site ends up being a little bit younger, you know, maybe a millennium or so younger than Arlington Springs, but it gave us the context, you know, no human remains here, but it gave us these detailed artifact assemblages. There were a lot of seabirds and other fauna remains that came out of this that started painting a picture of what people were doing on the Channel Islands in this early occupation. Of course, other sites on San Miguel Island, a couple sites on Santa Cruz, also fit into this general window of time between about 12,000 or 12,200 up to about 10,000 years ago that end up being some of the oldest coastal sites anywhere in the Americas, older than anywhere we know of on the California coastal mainland. And they show us some very sophisticated maritime adaptations early on in the colonization history of the Channel Islands. And then what happens next to me is what's so crucial. We're often focused on this, you know, when's the first, the earliest? It's this sort of very keen and interesting topic. But to me, a big question is, well, what happened next? You know, I started off by telling you that the Channel Islands then were, you know, had these densely populated hunter-gatherers late in time. Well, what happened in the intervening 10,000 years? And that's a story we've been working to build and understand along with our other colleagues working elsewhere on the Channel Islands over the last 20 years or more. One thing I should say before I go too much further is we're really lucky on the Channel Islands to have a pretty large research community. There's a number of people that work on these relatively small islands, ranging from students of Mike Glasow at UCSB to Amy at the LA County Museum to me here at the Smithsonian, John Erlinson, the University of Oregon. The names go on, and a whole number of new PhDs too, and all of that allows us to really get some in-depth and very nice reconstructions of that 10,000 year period after colonization. This is just one of the sites I wanted to highlight, SRI 666, the site of the beast, we called it. It's 8,000 years old. It's located on this sort of Badlands area in the middle there. And we excavated these shell midden exposures, like you can see on the left there. That's about a meter and a half in diameter, roughly. And it's sort of a cemented mix of shell and so a little bit of bone and artifacts that date to that period just after that first 2,000 years or so of colonization. And this site shows us that there was an ancient estuary nearby. There's no estuaries on the Channel Islands today. This is the only clearly documented one, though I think we may start finding signs of other ones too. This is on eastern Santa Rosa Island in the Abalone Rocks area. And this site ended up being pretty important for showing us the harvesting of estuarine clams, and then also the exploitation of geophytes or blue dicks, these beautiful purple flowers where Kristen Hoppe, Christina Gill, and others have been doing ethnobotanical work on the islands and finding that unlike oaks that were the most common on the mainland, people seem to have had an economy or at least a terrestrial plant economy focused more on these geophytes. And we've got them popping up in this 8,000-year-old site, SRI 666. And then also, some were found in Daisy Cave that are even a little bit older than that. Another important site type in this middle Holocene period, as we call it, the period after that initial colonization, this long stretch of time that goes from about 8,000 to 4,000 years ago, one of the more important site types we see on the Northern Channel Islands and then also on San Nicolas Island are what we call red abalone middens. There's a couple pictures of red abalone middens. The one on the left is out on Simonton Cove area on the northwest part of San Miguel Island. It's about 5,500 years old, if memory serves. You can see the big red abalone shells popping out of that intact deposit. And then the one on the right is from western Santa Rosa Island, a little bit older there. You can see a mix of black and red abalones in that one. And the thing that this slide on the left shows you is just this, how beautiful and well-preserved the archaeological record of the Channel Islands is. You've got whole shells, some of the muscles are still articulated together, eroding to be sure, but intact, really nice, well-preserved samples for study. And these sites show us people were harvesting a wide variety of rocky shore shellfish, some fish at this time. We lose those beautiful points, the CIB points and crescents are gone. People are no longer using those technologies. During this time, they're using more simplified bifaces, projectile point type artifacts that are a little more simple to make, as well as grinding stones and mortars and pestles, sort of during the later period of this time. And then another two sites I want to highlight, one of which you have collections generated by Charles Roser from Daisy Cave. And then the other one is Cave of the Chimneys. They're two sort of sister caves. They both sit on either side of Bay Point on San Miguel Island. Daisy Cave, of course, was revisited by John Erlinson, who built on the pioneering landmark work of Roser and Kritzman out at that site. And John was still working out there when I started grad school. So one of the first sites where I worked was Daisy Cave, working both in the front of the rock shelter you can see on the left photo, and then back into the interior portion of the cave too, which is one of the more creepy areas that I've ever worked. It's very, very compact, and you can actually hear the waves are kind of cutting under, forming another series of caves right now. And you can hear it kind of billow up when you're on the inside. And then Cave of the Chimneys there, you can see that look is another beautiful spot with really well-preserved and excellent records of human occupation. The two of them seem to have been like occupied at different intervals. So they provide this nice 12,000 year sequence where you get Daisy Cave, then there's a series of abandonments, and then you get Cave of the Chimneys, and then people come back. It's not quite that neat, but there's interesting overlapping occupations there. Really amazing preservation. I'm sure you know about the sandal and things that came out of there, the woven perishable technology out of Daisy Cave and similarly out of Cave of the Chimneys. But it's sites like these, and you can see that 12,000 to 1,000 years ago, that are sort of a dream for us archaeologists, because they tell us what people were doing in one location for this long span of time. And certainly people are radiating out from here. They're not just sitting in the cave alone, but they tell us all about people's life ways, how they were adapting to the landscape, and really allows us to look at environmental change, the things people, anthropogenic forces that might have been driving some of the changes we see as well. And then if we jump forward, so you can see we're kind of stair-stepping that sequence up. We start out with those early colonization and sites like SRI 512 that date to around 12,000 years ago, with crescents and arena points and hunting of extinct Chandites lawi and other organisms. And you move into these red abalone middens and then some of the estuary exploitation, cave sites. Then all of a sudden, after about 3,500 years ago, you hit what we call the late Holocene, and things just explode. It's like a cultural fluorescence that happens, particularly on the northern Channel Islands with the island Chumash. And after about 2,000 years ago, you see every beautiful watershed around the islands has a large village with it. Many of those villages you can visit today and still see the house depressions and get a sense of how the village might have been laid out. So you get these dense midden deposits and villages that I'll show you in a second, as well as smaller sites. And I wanted to show this here to give a little shout out to my colleague, Todd Bragey, I've done a lot of work at these sites with him, but this actually is a small cluster of black abalone in a Chinese abalone camp that dates to the early 19th century. And that's that next phase after Native American occupation. I just wanted to throw that in quickly as an aside, but some of these sites I'm talking about, these dense sites that appear during the late Holocene, look like this. This is at SMI 528 out near Point Bennett, the big pinniped rookery area of San Miguel. That's Quinton Shoup, a Chumash collaborator and monitor of ours, and then Todd Bragey on the right. You can see this giant whale vertebrae sticking out of the midden that's full of pinnipeds, seals and sea lions, fishes, shellfish, and a whole series of artifacts that show the really the great intensity in which people were harvesting marine foods, and then also the sophistication of the various technologies and cultural practices they have. I haven't worked on them lately, but my dissertation work and subsequent work was really focused on the understanding what we call emergent complexity, or the sort of appearance of Chumash complex village structure. And you know, some villages might have had 100 residents in them, with perhaps hereditary chiefs, so there's some debate about that. And I was really interested in understanding that formation that all seems to really intensify during the last 3,500 years. These two pictures here are out in that abalone rocks area where I mentioned the estuary was about 8,000 years ago. The one on the left, you can kind of see undulating landscape a little bit on that grassy area in the center of the photo, and that's a dense midden deposit, shell midden, so the all the shell refuse people were leaving behind. This one dates to about 1,000 years ago through the historic period, so through the 19th century, and seems to be part of, along with another nearby site, SR-87, part of the Chumash village of Chukchuk. And I show this because sometimes you learn from ethnohistory and Chumash names the meaning of a place. Chukchuk means bird droppings. That was the Chumash name from this village, and we know about it from baptismal records. And one of the times I went out there, I saw captured this photo on a foggy Santa Rosa Island morning that was just full of more seabirds than I'd ever seen congregating in one spot in my life. And I mean, anybody who's been to the Channel Islands, you've seen a lot of seabirds, especially Anacapa with the gulls and breeding season. But this was just incredible for me. And I think we got an understanding of where that bird droppings name came from. There's, you know, several, certainly over two dozen, I think, villages on the Northern Channel Islands of Santa Cruz, Santa Rosa, and San Miguel, these named Chumash villages. So ones that were described in ethnographic records for which there are baptisms that correspond to mission records. Most of those have been relocated. I did my dissertation work at one called Nyakla, or SRI-2, that Phil Orr actually also worked at. This is a look at Nyakla. You can see on the left in the photo, it sticks out. The village sticks out like a sore thumb. It's in the very middle of the photo on that series of gulches there, where you can see the sort of darker green and reds of the ice plant, the cryptolan ice plant that just loved that nutrient-rich midden soil that's high in both calcium and especially nitrogen. And then there's a map of the site next to it of features of where Orr had excavated and then where I revisited. All those circles represent different house pits, different house dwellings where people would have lived. And then structure collapsed in and disintegrated. But these sites are pretty amazing because, one, they'd show us just how many people were out there. Remember, again, they're getting most of their protein from the sea, and then supplementing that with carbohydrates from terrestrial plants like geophytes and other foods, probably acorns to a smaller extent, though we surprisingly don't see a lot of those in the archaeological record. And I wanted to just show you a few things. This was like a trip from memory lane for me, looking at some of these artifacts that I analyzed during my dissertation work. And for those of you who've seen the you know, work with Amy Gusick or Chris Coleman or others in the LA County Anthropological Archaeology collections, have seen things like these. You guys have world-class collections that mirror these. These pictures come from the Santa Barbara Museum of Natural History. There might be one or two from Smithsonian collections tucked in here too. We have some collections from early 19th century work as well. But a swordfish rostrum there on the right, so you can think of a big swordfish beak. This one was modified up in the top right, probably for a handle, though it's not totally clear what that was for. And then some fluorite beads on the left there. They're the purple fluorite. John Johnson at the Santa Barbara Museum of Natural History and I have been working to try to figure out where these fluorite beads are coming from. They all occur during the historic period, and it's a question of people either locally producing them, perhaps coming in from as far away as Peru or China, something we hope to pin down in the next couple of years. Other, you know, beautiful artifacts in these collections. There's an asphaltum on the left, or tar with a basketry impression for their water bottles. a woven seagrass bag that came out of SRI 2. During our excavations there, when we revisited the site, we found a similar bag as this too. And then, you know, we get the story of the Channel Islands becomes the story of this early colonization and the stair stepping up to these beautiful villages of the late Holocene. We often lose sight of the fact that the smallest islands, so Anacapa Island and Santa Barbara in the southern group, were also occupied by people. Anacapa at least 6,000 years ago through radiocarbon dates, and we found a crescent was actually found out there by McCusick back in the late 50s that suggests, you know, an early Holocene occupation. Of course, the northern islands were all together, connected in one single landmass, never to the mainland, but connected to each other during the Pleistocene, and so Anacapa would have been part of that. But we found a site, we excavated ANI-2, which is on East Anacapa, and if you've ever been out there and hiked the main trail, you've walked right across ANI-2, and this site actually blew us away because it produced really interesting faunal assemblages, fair amount of porpoise remains, even a couple whale bones that were scavenged, a lot of harbor seal, California sea lion, and then the bones of at least one individual island fox. And this is an island where island foxes don't occur today. And all those dated to around 2,500 or 3,000 years ago. And of course, you guys have some pretty neat collections from Anacapa too, from Rosaire's work out at a cave site at ANI-8, and then also an open air site on West Anacapa at ANI-6 and 5, I think you worked that too. So what I want to do now is jump in and kind of start wrapping up by talking about the second portion of the talk, which is what this can tell us in a nutshell about biodiversity. But just to remind you guys that we just scratched the surface, but it sort of hopefully whets your appetite for just how exciting and diverse the archaeological record of the Channel Islands is. And a lot of it is piecing together that long millennial scale story of the spectacular maritime colonization all the way up through the classic defined Chumash that we know of from ethnographic sources in the last 1500 years or so ago. And we've used that framework then to try to relate archaeology and the record of human occupation to the biology, ecology, and biodiversity of the Channel Islands. And so we've held a couple workshops and working groups with different managers and biologists, and Greg Pauly from LA County was involved in a lot of that work. And we came up with this framework piecing together sort of the pre-human era, so that time greater than 13,000 years ago when there were no humans on the island and beautiful pygmy mammoths were roaming the islands. It must have been a spectacular place for seabirds and for pinnipeds as well. And then you get through into the heuristic of that human occupation and down into the ranching period, and then ultimately in the conservation and management area for Catalina Island Conservancy, the National Park Service, U.S. Navy, of course, and other groups, Tient Nature Conservancy, and other groups. So we've used that kind of framework to understand what the human past, and what the centuries-long story can tell us, not just about what happened long ago, but how it can help us understand how we got to the present, how it can tell us a little bit about the present, and then ultimately how we can look at the perspective of past climate change, past anthropogenic influence on nearshore ecosystems and other organisms to then help us think about, well, how does this fit into our management and what we want the Channel Islands of the future to be like, especially in an era of such great climatic uncertainty as we're living in now and will be living in for the foreseeable future. Before I dive into just a couple of these quick notes of examples of work that we've been doing to engage in these biodiversity topics, is to remind you guys that while I've showed a lot of artifacts and talked about some really interesting artifacts, for me, what gets me most excited as an archaeologist is the boring stuff. And what you're looking at there on the left is a cover of the journal Trends in Ecology and Evolution with a drawer of unsorted shell midden on it. I never thought I'd get to see a drawer of unsorted midden on a journal cover, but we were lucky to get that. And that unsorted midden there with abalone shells and fishes and a really nice date to it. And then on the right there is bone that's been sorted out to different categories and just waiting for really specific taxonomic identification or stable isotope analysis, DNA, collagen fingerprinting, you name it. Those bones that aren't that exciting to look at and they don't, you know, get a sense of wonder like a crescent or a Channel Island barbed point might, they have just fantastic stories to tell us about the people, ecosystems, and coastlines and terrestrial landscapes of the Channel Islands through time. And so just a quick run through as I wrap up here is to think about the issues we've looked at. So we've placed the Channel Islands in the context of quaternary extinction and shown that actually extinction, which is a big part of the late Pleistocene in the mainland and mainland continents, it wasn't all that common on the Channel Islands. We have the mammoths, and of course I know that's not a picture of a mammoth, it's an elephant swimming there on the left, but mammoths went extinct, perhaps overlapping with people, though there's still a lot of questions about the role people might have played in their extinction. If anything, I think they were probably the coup de grace, the sort of final straw. We have a giant mouse, Paramiscus nesodites, that goes extinct, but looks like now that story of extinction is the current mouse, Paramiscus maniculata, seems to have been introduced by Native Americans around 9 to 10,000 years ago, probably unintentionally. Over the next like couple centuries, gets outcompeted by Paramiscus and goes extinct by about probably 2,000 or 3,000 years ago, maybe later. There's still some question about that after its competition. And then Tendites lawi is a extinct flightless scooter that, went extinct during the Middle Holocene, but had a long period of coexistence with people. And then if there's anyone on the line from the tar pits, I just want to give a shout out to work we just did with Alexis Mikhailo, one of your former postdocs and current research associates, which was pinning down the story of this small single bone you can see down there from Daisy Cave that had been kicking around for over a decade. We did genetic analysis, collagen fingerprinting, isotopes and radiocarbon dating on this and showed that there was a short-faced bear. Must have been a scary sight out on the Channel Islands. Other than mammoths, this is the only evidence of any Rancho La Brea fauna out on the Channel Islands. Unfortunately, the story is not that this bear swam out there. The story is actually that it was probably a paw or something carried out by a bird and subsequently deposited in the thing. We went through a variety of hypotheses. This diagram, though, can show you kind of that interesting thing, which you see the human dates of human occupation. And now with new calibrations and things, humans were definitely overlapping with mammoths, though we still have no direct evidence for their coexistence. I know you have Bob Wayne coming up. We'll talk a lot about foxes. There's a lot of evidence for translocations, people introducing animals to the Channel Islands prehistorically. The island fox, still some question whether or not people brought out the first gray foxes to the Northern Islands, but we can definitely say with certainty that people introduced foxes from the northern to the southern Channel Islands sometime around 6,000 years ago. We're wrapping up an ancient DNA study on those. It builds on some isotope work that's been done. We have some evidence we haven't published yet suggesting that the Catalina Island ground school was brought up by Native Americans maybe 2,000 to 3,000 years ago. No evidence for skunk translocation yet, but there's an interesting story there to look at. And then of course, deer mice, we're wrapping up some genetic work there that supports a translocation of those. I put this up here just to show you there's a double dog burial that my colleague Renee Blanwith excavated on San Nicolas Island. But the current dates for the arrival of dogs on the Channel Islands and foxes are roughly contemporaneous, about 7,000 years ago. And then genetic data push it back a little. The other topics we've looked at is just walk through is what we call novel reassembly of pinnipeds. Of course, pinnipeds were driven to the verge of extinction, seals and sea lions all throughout the world during the global fur and oil trade. They're one of the great conservation success stories. You know, all of you that have traveled up the One and been to San Simeon and Año Nuevo have seen our big blubbering elephant seal colonies. I've been doing some work at Point Conception and they're showing up there even now. And I mean, I saw sea otters at Point Conception recently. It's just amazing to see the recovery of marine mammals. It's a real story of ocean optimism. And they're even getting into trouble, apparently ending up in highway patrol cars. But it's also a story that differs from the past. And we've been very interested in using archaeology to understand their recovery and showing that, you know, the past, the late Holocene in particular, Guadalupe fur seals, you can see that gray diagram there, were really common in the past. And then the present, they're nowhere to be found. It's sort of a mirror image with elephant seals that weren't very common in the past, but abundant today. I don't intend for you to absorb this, but we just did collagen fingerprinting to identify these fragments of bone. We knew very little about pinniped hunting prior to 5,000 years ago, really prior to 3,000 years ago. And so we started using collagen fingerprinting, which is a more simple technique to genetics, to identify these 11 to 12,000 year old bones here. And we actually found a high number of elephant seals in those that differs from anything we see later And I've been hypothesizing that maybe this recovery actually is somewhat natural and that it's shifting more towards this pre-human baseline where the channel has a lot of work done that needs to be done to figure that out, but it shows another way that archaeology can build on that. We've done work on dune building. This is a nearly 100 foot tall dune. You see in the very middle of the slide there, it's 1200 BP. That's me and another guy standing there on top of this 100 foot tall dune on San Miguel Island at Otter Point. Each one of those shows an intact archaeological deposit. This is like a layer cake where you've got 7,200 years old at the bottom, and then people leave and sand blows in and makes a dune. People come back at 6,000 years ago, they repeat that, the sand blows in, and you get this cake of sand dune that forms there. And the entire north coast of San Miguel, northwest coast actually is like this. And really it's showing that people were making these sort of mega dunes that occur. There would be dunes on the Channel Islands, but I'm not sure there would be mega dunes quite like this. And these actually end up being pretty important for some insect, particularly beetle biodiversity on the islands. They're also some of the most threatened by climate change and sea level rise too, because sea level rise will eat at these coastal dunes that are sitting right there. The last one is just to think about as humans and fire. California Indians and really indigenous people around the world are well known for using fire as a management tool. And the Channel Islands are no exception to that. But until recently, we didn't have a lot of evidence for this. Let's see if I can bring up. There we go. We didn't have a lot of evidence for this until recently. This is work by Scott Anderson showing a spike that he says, hopefully you can see my cursor right here, around after 45,000 years ago, great increase in charcoal in two sequences. Another one here you can kind of see. That does correlate with increased population density and might be signs of increased Native American burning. There's good ethnographic sources of burning for the Chumash on the mainland, but they're largely silent on the islands. But in the future, I think the next 10 years or so, this will be a crucial area for investigation is to understand how people in the past were using fire as a management tool, both on the California islands and the mainland, and can be a technique to really help us understand these terrible increasing fires that are happening throughout California. So to kind of sum up, I guess my main takeaway is one, the Channel Islands record is spectacular, but we can go further than that and show how the Channel Islands have really been managed by people for thousands of years. And I put that in quotes because management means different things to different people, but this is a landscape of people, the Chumash, the Gabrielino Tongva, who intimately knew their landscape. We have very little evidence for extinction, of course. We have very little evidence for really any huge declines in resources. Sure, we see declines in pinnipeds, we see declining in mussel size, but the overarching story of the long term is one of incredible sustainability. And then we see that management just continues through time. And we get the ranching landscape that comes and of course represents a major change to the Channel Islands, introduction of all sorts of exotics. And most of management today has been trying to get the Channel Islands back to their prehistoric state. But what these tell us is that history of the Channel Islands, these occupations, all add up to the Channel Islands that we see today. And that the past is a direct link to the present and can provide us some guide into looking towards the future. And the final point I just want to leave you with is that we need to both learn from and protect the past. The archaeological record, the historical record of the islands has a ton to tell us, but it's also threatened. And this is a site, a huge village site out on southern Santa Cruz Island. You can see the big midden exposure, the white dotted there, that's being hammered by marine erosion. We're losing sites every year to marine erosion in California and elsewhere around the world. And it's up to us to become stewards of that record and try to protect it. And it's also on us to work closely with the indigenous communities of the area, with the Chumash and Gabrielino Tongva, to both protect and understand this archaeological record in the future. So with that, thank you very much.
Thank you so much for that wonderful presentation, Dr. Rick. So if anybody has any questions for Dr. Rick, please put them in the Q&A and I will ask them. And we actually have one question so far. And so this is a question from Jody, which is, were whales actually harvested or hunted by some of these early inhabitants, or are the remains largely from washed up whales that have not been actively hunted but might have been scavenged?
Great question. So this is a question that archaeologists have been trying to answer since at least the 50s, if not earlier. Robert Heiser actually wrote a paper back in the late 50s, I think it was, called Was There Whaling Amongst the Chumash? The easy answer is no, that the Chumash were not sort of a classic whaling group. They weren't known to be out hunting gray whales and humpbacks and orcas and things like that. Really, you have to go all the way up to Vancouver Island or the Olympic Peninsula of Washington until you get really classic evidence of Native American whaling. Now, there are exceptions to that. One of those is a site I've been working at with some graduate students in Seaside, Oregon, where there's clear evidence now of incipient whaling, people hunting younger gray whales that come into estuaries and maybe a combo of strandings and other events. The evidence in California right now on the Channel Islands points to mostly scavenging of beached whales. Now that said, there is some pretty clear evidence for hunting of dolphins and porpoises. Mike Glasow has documented that pretty clearly around 5,000 years ago at the Punta Arenas site, where Amy's done a lot of work on Santa Cruz Island. Right around that same time, you also see evidence for hunting of dolphins and porpoises both at the Little Harbor site on Catalina Island and also at Eel Point on San Clemente Island. So there was some kind of dolphin and porpoise hunting. There's speculation about whether they were herding them to beach on shore, not quite clear exactly how that happened. But then the Chumash, they were definitely hunting swordfish. And so you can imagine being out in an open canoe in the middle of the Santa Barbara Channel, hunting and harpooning swordfish is a really complicated activity. So certainly they had the capabilities, they just don't seem to have been doing it.
So our next question we have from Greg is, when we look at the colonization history of the Americas, some early sites are on islands, Orcas, Santa Rosa, and the Coronados. People are on these islands when direwolves, short-faced bear, brown bear, smilodon, etc. are on the mainland. Islands were both located with marine protein resources, but also free from major predators. Any thoughts on early land use patterns being driven in part by predator avoidance?
Yeah, that's another great question. So I haven't seen anyone who's actually put that in print, and we certainly haven't put it in print, but that would be an added benefit of being on any of these islands, would be even some of the islands in Southeast Alaska that people would have had to island hop through. But no, I haven't actually thought like put that out there, but certainly a possibility. Another sort of, I guess, related issue to that is, imagine the bounty of foods that were on these islands too. So if you have smilodon and short-faced bears and things that are gonna hammer pinniped rookeries and things on the mainland, imagine what they're like on an islands that have been free from predators. So I think it could have been all those things, predator avoidance, then the abundance of foods and resources from that. And so, yeah, that's certainly a big part of it. Another part of it, a more basic one, is that sadly, particularly in California and more developed parts of Oregon, Washington, and Canada, development has really trashed a lot of archaeological sites, taken away some of our temporal resolution. And then, the darn pocket gopher, badgers, and other organisms burrow up these sites, and it can make it really hard to find early sites that are well preserved. There was just a 10,100-year-old site found in the Sutton Flats area up in Vandenberg Air Force Base, though. So that's starting to push things back in mainland California. But yeah, that predator avoidance thing is a good one.
Great, thank you. So our next question is from Scott, who asks, during human occupation, what was the source of water and food?
Yeah, great question. So we've always thought that the Channel Islands were kind of marginal. And I was just part of a book, and I think Amy was too, called the Archaeology of Abundance, which tried to turn that on its head. And marginal meaning, the Channel Islands, they don't have the diversity of terrestrial resources that the mainland does. They don't have the water. And what we're finding out is that actually, as we move further and further away from the ranching era, and as we see the islands recover under Park Service, Nature Conservancy, Navy, other management, we're seeing watersheds restored. And there's springs in places that we never thought there were springs. There's more abundant water. And so some of these islands are actually quite well watered. It's still California, these are still semi-arid. We have to take that in caution. But what people were doing was storing water. They were, using asphaltum to line baskets, some cases big ones, to keep water in. It must have tasted terrible, but an ingenious technique for capturing water. And then late in time, when people lived in those large villages, there's evidence for human health declines and disease, probably coming from potentially polluted water sources or degraded water sources. And then as far as foods go, the Channel Islands, you know, most of the protein was coming from marine foods, everything from nearshore kelp forest fishes to abalones to California mussels to swordfish, in the case when those were caught, not all the time, but when they were caught, those would be probably part of feasting events. And then people were certainly on the mainland, you know, people had access to a greater variety of foods. And we think people were probably, you know, bringing some things out, certainly usable materials like deer bone, maybe acorn from the mainland in a processed form, though there's almost no evidence of acorns on the island. So it's a real interesting topic right now.
Great, thank you so much. So our next question, we've got just 2 minutes left. So we're gonna say two more questions. So first is from Xiaoming, who asks, can you say something more about the island fox? Do you think they were brought to the island by Paleo Indians? How do you evaluate the evidences regarding this?
Yeah, so we, back in 2010, something like that, we published a paper where we advanced about five pieces of evidence that support a human introduction of foxes to the Channel Islands. And one of those was that there's no pre-human fossil or subfossil record. Island foxes show up in the record everywhere. And that's after some pretty intensive looking after like 10,000 years ago. And actually the oldest ones are only 7,200 years old. And then we've supported that with some anecdotal evidence. So there were breeding bird colonies, seabird colonies on the mainland portions of the Northern Channel Islands that Dan Guthrie has documented. And those types of birds were on offshore rocks that were free from foxes. And so that seemed to be another parallel. And again, when the foxes were brought into captive breeding, what we saw was an explosion of some of these breeding birds on the mainland portions of the islands again, as the foxes are released, those shrink. That's the work of Charles Drost. And so having that parallel back in the Pleistocene was another piece of that support. And then since that time, we've done a lot of stable isotope work on a suite of hundreds of fox bones from archaeological, historical samples, as well as modern samples, showing on San Nick some dietary overlap with humans and dogs, and maybe some potential feeding there, particularly on a couple pups. That's not widespread though. It's not occurring on the Northern Channel Islands. This fox showing up on Anacapa is interesting. We can't say if it was alive or what it was, but there's another piece of that evidence. This is all, a lot of this has been published. Courtney Hoffman, one of my students, did her dissertation on this work. I'd be happy to send more of those papers. It's still controversial. I would say we can definitely say that people transported foxes to the southern islands. There's very few people would argue against that. It's whether or not people first transported out that first gray fox to the islands. Right now, it looks like they might have, but we still need more work on that. I think some of the ancient work we're talking, I don't know, I don't think Bob Wayne's a big fan of it, but I haven't talked to him about it. We'll see. But I'm happy to send papers.
Awesome. Thank you so much. So it's actually 101 now. So I'm going to, unfortunately, for those of you that didn't have time to have your questions asked, I'm very sorry. But we want to respect everyone's time. So I'm sure we have a huge virtual applause for Dr. Rick to thank him for his wonderful seminar. And thank everybody for attending.
Thank you so much for having me. And if anybody wants, feel free to email me questions. I'm happy to answer them. And good luck with your exhibit.
Great. Thank you.